Okay, who here, by show of hands, loves public speaking? You wake up in the morning and you are disappointed when you don't get to go on stage and talk to people. Y'all, nobody? Okay, oh, we've got one person. Okay, that's more than I expected because I have never been a big fan. Okay, everybody stand up. All right, now put your hands on your hips and take a step out, like kind of like you're posing like Superman, and puff your chest out like you're a superhero, and hold the pose. I'll get to why you're here in a second. So 5 or 6 years ago, I started a new job. I was working for our chief marketing officer, and he said, I need you to get on stage in 2 weeks and talk to us about how you're gonna help us address our corporate culture challenges at AT&T. So I spent more time those 2 weeks looking at ways of getting over stage fright than I did writing my talking points. And I came across a woman named Amy Cuddy, who, she's a psychologist, she did a TED talk on the power pose. And she said that if you stand for 2 minutes in a power pose, you trick your brain and your body into feeling more confident than you really are. So I had this plan. I'm gonna go backstage before I get in front of 1,500 people for the first time ever. I'm gonna power pose before it's my turn to get up there. I'm gonna feel awesome, knock it out of the park. And then my boss of a month at the time was hanging out backstage. So I am sitting here like trying to figure out how to like awkwardly like power pose, and he's like, are you okay? Like what are you doing? So then I had to do it all over again the following year, and I told him that story, and he came on stage with me and power posed with me. So I felt a lot less ridiculous, and now he understood why I looked like a crazy person. He now knew I was a crazy person and joined in on the fun. So y'all should feel super confident right now because you've been power posing for 2 minutes. I feel much better because I've just got to watch all 400-ish of you power pose, and I'm ready to go. So have a seat, and I promise that relates back to something I'm going to talk about later. Okay, I am so excited to be here today. That picture is clearly of me when I was younger. I am the IVR Transformation Lead for AT&T. Basically, I own all of the IVR technology and some of our omni-channel technology that we are working on implementing. Started this role within AT&T about 18 months ago, and when they recruited me for this job, I had to Google what IVR was. I had no idea. A sponsor of mine said, go for it, take the risk, it's gonna be worth it. I'm sure all of you guys are AT&T customers, and I'm sure you've never had to call our IVR, but if you have, you probably know that the experience isn't always that exciting. I'm trying to change that. When they asked me to do this, though, I thought, like, this is gonna be the most boring job ever. Who wants to own the IVR? They had a plan, AT&T had a plan. I had no IVR experience, but they wanted me to come in and use my ability to lead change in order to help transform it. My boss was an IVR expert. 9 days after I started the job, he left. So I had 30 days to learn IVR technology before I had to get in front of our chief customer officer. And that was an experience. I learned as quickly as I could, and I presented to her some ideas that we'll just say we're a little bit different than what most people would expect. There's also a reason that I'm telling you guys about this here. So that brings me to where we're at today. We are very channel-centric. Can anybody relate to this in your organizations? Raise your hands, yes. So we have people who can call us, and about close to 300 million people call us a year. We have people who chat us. It's about, I don't know, 28 million customers a year. We have people who tweet us, who go on Instagram. There's people who walk into brick and mortar stores. The one thing that we're missing here, though, is the connective tissue that allows our agents to give our customers a complete experience. If they are chatting with us, they have to completely start over if they need to call us. That means they go to the top of the IVR, they answer the same prompts that everybody else answers. It's an incredibly frustrating experience for our customers. And then by the time they get to the agents, our agents pay for it, right? Customers most of the time, realize that it's not the agent who caused the problem, but that's the person who's on the receiving end of the frustration. What we are now working towards is a customer-centric model. So like I said, we're building that connective tissue, but it goes beyond just the initial connective tissue that I mentioned. We are focusing on all of our customers. So since I own technology, consumers, right, that's gonna be our first customer. The agents, they're our second customer. If you have happy agents, they're more happy to service your customers better. And then our shareholders, right? Anybody here wanna provide an amazing customer experience and the first question you get is, what's the ROI? That is like the number one thing I hear almost daily. So how do we make all three customers happy? We start by designing the technology around each of our customers. I don't know about you guys, but historically AT&T has taken a, we are the technology experts, we're gonna tell you how you want to be served, as opposed to you tell us how you want us to serve you. Our consumers want three things. I'm sure they want more than three things, but these are the top three things according to J.D. Power. First and foremost, they want to choose how they are served. Not a novel concept, right? Seems like common sense. But we don't make that easy. If customers have to move from channel to channel with nothing that helps them do that seamlessly, it's a painful experience. Number two, timeliness of resolution. So how quickly can you get from the start of your problem or your question to solution? And then three, the amount of customer effort as it correlates, that correlates to our CSAT. So everybody calls it something different, voice of customer, CSAT, but the more effort a customer has to put forth to get something done, the less satisfied they are. Next, we have our agents. So what do our agents want? First and foremost, our agents want happy customers. This is like a chicken and an egg situation, right? Our agents want to make our customers happy, but our customers don't come to them happy if they have a poor experience in the way that they arrive to the agent. They need tools that enable great customer service. If the agents don't have the systems and the tooling and the permissions that they need in order to serve the customer, they can't do an effective job. And then lastly, we need to incentivize the agents in a way that motivates them and drives the right behavior. How many of you guys have KPIs or metrics or OKRs that you have for your agents? Anybody? Have you discovered that through any of the experiences that you've had that those unintentionally drive poor behavior? Like, AT&T measures their agents on transfer rate. So why we were shocked when we found out agents were telling customers to call back and not transfer them blows my mind. How do we incentivize our agents in a way that motivates them? And then lastly, we have our shareholders. Now, some of you guys may not be public companies, but think about this as the business, right? We have a business to operate. It would be great if we can throw all the money in the world towards the technology and the customer experience, but we still have to stay afloat. So what do our shareholders want? They also want three things. They want profitable returns. So how do we deliver this? First and foremost, I love the turtle. I call this the crawl, walk, run approach. For me, shifting the mindset has been the crawl for me. Getting everybody who has been in contact centers for the last 25 years to think about doing things differently and putting our agents first and our customers first before putting the OPEX savings first or the revenue generation first has been incredibly difficult. By far the hardest thing that I've had to do so far. Next, the walk approach. This is the technology, right? We've got 50,000 agents that work for AT&T. Some of them are our vendor agents. Some of them are internal. We take 300 million calls a year. We take 28 million chats a year around that. Anytime that we're gonna make a shift in technology, it's gotta be very strategic and there's gotta be a plan. One failure in migration or blip in the road, if we take AT&T's contact center technology down, even for an hour, it causes pure chaos. AT&T is focused on simplifying their telephony stack. So think about this. We were SBC, and then we merged with AT&T. Every time that we acquire a new company, whether it be big or small, we're stitching together the different technologies. So you've got Band-Aids, we've got three routing platforms, two IVRs, I think 12 CRM systems. I can't even count the number of call queuing systems that we have. We're working on streamlining that, moving it to the cloud. This gives us ample opportunity to improve the customer experience because you're not hopping from all these different systems, and you can track the customer journey with data end to end. We also are very focused on low touch authentication. Does anybody have AT&T in here that's willing to raise their hand? who? Anybody call the IVR? Okay, all the way in the back, in the green shirt. When you call the IVR, what are you asked for today to authenticate? If you remember. Okay, maybe our new technology is working for you then. But currently, for certain intents that you're calling about, AT&T asks you for a PIN or a passcode that you have to remember. 80% of our customers remember one of their PINs or passcodes. You have to have a PIN or passcode for every product. So our customers spend a lot of time with agents trying to validate who they are. Wastes agent handle time, drives up operating expense, not a good customer experience or an agent experience. So we're working on low-touch authentication. We recently deployed technology that allows us to authenticate customers by their handset device. They don't even know they're being authenticated, and it's a secure method. Trust me, if anybody knows security, it's AT&T because we're highly regulated. Then there are certain intents like changing your plan, canceling service. That requires a higher authentication method. We will be deploying end of year push notification technology. So as opposed to memorizing a PIN, you're just gonna get a little note on your phone that says, hey, are you trying to call the IVR? I'm sure it won't say it like that because nobody knows what an IVR is. Yes, you are, and you're authenticated for the next 90 days. We're working to take that effort off of the customer. We're also getting smarter with our technology. We're using AI. We're using AI solutions for routing to learn more about our customers and their behaviors in the IVR. How can we use technology to help us help our customers and therefore help our agents? And then lastly, we are focused on common agent tooling and desktops. Those 12 CRM systems, nothing flows through when you move different channels. Everything is disconnected. Customers have to constantly repeat themselves. It's a terrible experience. It drives, again, agent handle time and a poor agent experience as well. We're working on having one common platform. So as customers move from channel to channel, whether they're chatting, they're in a store, they call the IVR, the agent can see everything the customer has done and serve them the way that they want to be served without making them start from the beginning. So our run phase is scaling. We are not there yet, but we are making sure that we're set up by success. We've got the shift in mindset checked off. We've got the technology in place. Once that technology component finishes, we'll be working on scaling. How do we get customers used to the new experience with AT&T? How do we get them excited to play? Right now, we've got a 30% non-player rate. Non-players are people who either engage in chat or the IVR and they automatically press zero or they say agent, agent, agent. If we can make our technology better, we can serve our customers better and we'll teach them how to play with us. To tie it all together, and now the first little power pose activity we did will perfectly make sense. This is what I feel is needed in order to make a total customer experience transformation. We did the power pose for confidence in terms of preparing for interviews or when you go on stage, but confidence is absolute key when you're trying to transform technology. You are gonna have a lot of doubters. If you have not started this journey yet, you are gonna have people who don't believe that this is the right way to do it. You're gonna have people who question everything that you're doing. If you don't have the confidence in yourself to lead something like this, you're setting yourself up for failure. A here is audacity. I mentioned the story about my mentor or my sponsor telling me to take a risk and do something bold. Try this even though I had zero interest in running an IVR. That has paid off for me. I've learned so much in this role. I've always had a passion for customer experience. I now have a passion for employee experience, which at the time, I never even thought was a thing. Same thing applies though for what you're doing in the IVR, in your total experience transformations. You have to be bold and you have to think differently. You have to have the audacity to challenge thinking that's the status quo. Next is perseverance. Like I mentioned with the confidence, if you don't consistently push past everybody who is doubting you and you're not persistent in the message that you're trying to drive and the transformation efforts you're trying to make, it is not going to be successful. Next is patience. The one thing that I do not have is patience, but this is a long process. Like I said, I started this role 18 months ago, and just now I'm finally getting everybody to start talking more about total experience and how we can both improve things for the customer, for the agent, without harming our shareholder satisfaction either. So CAP is what I live by these days. That is all I've got for you guys. Thank you so much for your time.